All right. I'm James Overton, and unfortunately I can't be there with you in person, but I'm delighted to be able to present virtually to you on the OntoDev suite of tools for ontology and data integration. My co-author here is Becky Jackson, but really this is a community effort that spanned 10 years and a whole bunch of different people. And our goal with all these tools is to just help scientists make better use of ontologies, exactly the kinds of things that Melissa is talking about, where everywhere, databases, tables, papers, protocols, and especially want to help graduate students, postdocs, early career scientists make good use of these things. And I really want to help people meet them like where they are. So they're using Python or R JavaScript. I want them to be able to use it with the ontologies. And if they're using notebooks, I want them to be able to use our ontology stuff and whatever platforms they're on. And I want to give them web-based options. So I'm going to present to you today work on progress towards these different goals. And I'm organizing the talk in terms of kind of tables and trees, branches, and workflows. I want you to be thinking about these as we go. And I'm presenting a bunch of tools for each of those different things. On this side, tables, I really like using tables for editing. They're easy to think about and program with. There's lots of mature tools for working with tables, and TSV files are very good for version control. On the other hand, trees are great for browsing, and simple hierarchies get you a long way. We have RDF, we have OWL bringing logical power. And so all the stuff I'm going to show you today, think about moving back and forth between table views and tree views. And I'm also a huge fan of Git and Git branches, allowing people to work in parallel development. And I'm going to show you GitHub stuff, but GitLab should work just as well. And there's all the different clients. And workflows are really important to me. Workflows stored in version control. I'm going to show you stuff using GNU Make and installed inside Docker containers, but there's different options for these things. All right, and here we go with a live demonstration. So fingers crossed, wish me luck. This is my vision for how things should work. Here's a demo repository that you can find on GitHub if you like. Here, it's just kind of made up, but it's like a real ontology in that we have folders full of a whole bunch of tables for kind of template driven stuff. We have a bunch of scripts, and we have a make file, which helps coordinate those different scripts. And then we have a Docker file, which helps handle all the installation of all the different software that you might need. And you should be able to use this locally. And if you don't, put in a bug report. But what I want to show you today is a vision for online development and with zero install. And so this is how I think about it. So we can go to the issue list and find a particular issue. And it says that somebody needs to add the hamster strain ABC to our strain table. But first, we're going to have to actually add hamsters to our imports from the NCBI taxonomy. So I'm just going to copy this. And then the vision is that if you are a developer with write permissions on this repository, you should be able to click a magic link and move over to this system, which is called Droid. And I'll tell you more about it later. But basically, we're on a branch specifically for fixing this issue. This branch is running inside a Docker container with all your tools installed. On the right-hand side here, you have your basic version control options. On your left-hand side here, you have a curated list of actions for your workflows that are drawn from the make file. So these are different make actions and files and scripts that you can run. And these are customized for each project. And this kind of fits in between different things you might have seen. Unlike GitHub Actions or Jenkins, you can edit here. You're making changes on a branch. And unlike a full-fledged web IDE, we've curated the options that you can use. And so it's in between those two different features. And there's different. I'm going to show you different ways to edit our ontology, but we're going to start with a tool called Nanobot. So you click the Run button, and you jump over to this view. And here we have a list of our different tables that you just saw in the repository. And we have our upstream ontologies that are all loaded in. So here is our strain table. It's got 10,000 rows in it. It doesn't take any particular time to jump around between these things. And in this particular, you can use these tables for lots of different things. It could just be a table of data, but I really like ontology-driven data. And in particular, this one is we're using to generate an OWL file. And so from here, we can jump from our table into our tree where we've built an ontology using that template. And here's our rats are rodents or mammals. And then we have 5,000 different strains that I've randomly generated. They're just fictional. But the tool is designed so that we are able to handle 10,000 strains at a time. That's kind of interesting and useful. I use ontologies like the protein ontology, which I have thousands and thousands of children for a row. So I designed a tool where I'd be able to do it like this. All right, so in this particular system, we have an import table for managing where our imports come from. You can see we've got mice and rats from the NCBI taxonomy. And we want to add a new term into this table. So we want to import hamsters. And I'm just going to cheat once in this demonstration, and we're going to jump directly into the upstream version of the full NCBI taxonomy that we can browse around. It is fairly fast to browse around, even though it's got well over a million different nodes, but everything is in here. And we can find the term that we want, which is our Syrian hamster. And we can click this little button over here. And this button takes us to a table. So we were just in a tree, but now we're in our import table. And we're able to do autocomplete on these things. The autocomplete can be a little bit better, but we can pick our taxon, and that should fill out our rodentia. And here we go. And then we can validate this using a set of validation rules. We can submit it, and we've updated our import table. And so now you can see over here, our import table now has hamsters in it. So we're going to go back here and click a make task to reload our imports and our ontology. And down here, you can see the kinds of things that you might be used to if you're an ontology developer using other tools I've built, such as a robot. So here we're pulling the tables out of the database. We are extracting a few terms out of the 2 million terms in the NCBI taxonomy. It's actually fairly fast. We're running robot to do some templates and merges, and then we're loading it back into the database, and we're done. So over here, we can go back and we can find our term in our database now, in our demo ontology. So this is our kind of application ontology that we've built. So we've imported this term now. That's great. We're going to go back to the strain table. And then we're going to add our particular strain, our hamster strain ABC. So we're adding a new row to the table. So we insert like strain, we'll put in 100 for now. I'm going to paste in the particular strain. And then I get autocomplete on a bunch of things. This should be limited to just species, but for now, it's got a bunch more extra things. Oh, we hit a validation error. So we need to have a unique identifier for this. And you know, the tool should be able to auto-generate it, but for now, we're going to put it in manually, validate, check that it's okay, submit it. And so now we have one more row in our strain table. We can skip over here. We can jump to the end of the table, and we can see that the row is actually here. And then we can jump to this in the, we haven't rebuilt our ontology yet. So we do this one more time. So we're building it using our strain table to build our ontology, using some existing familiar tools such as robot to do some extractions, do some rebuilds, do some robot templates, shove it back into our database. And that takes, 20 seconds in this particular case. And the suspense, here we go. And then we can now, if I refresh this, it should work. We can go find our strain. And now we've got our ontology rebuilt with our particular strain in it. All right, so given all this, what can we do now? Well, we can switch back to our version control. So we've solved this issue. We do our diff. We see that we've added these two lines to our ontology table. Then we're going to create a commit. So our commit is going to be fix issue number one. Did that commit work? It did. And then we can push our commit. So we can create a push, and then from here we can create a pull request, and we click the link, and we're back in GitHub in exactly the place kind of that we started. We started with an issue, we created a pull request, we can merge this, and then we're done. We can have all the standard continuous integration, all the other stuff that you've got. You've got GitHub repositories or GitLab repositories. You've got all the good stuff working in it. And the tools are all designed to fit into your existing workflows. And then there's a couple more things I want to show you quickly. We can take the same table and we can open up in Google Sheets. So here's a case where we've loaded all of our tables into our Google Sheet. And so, for example, we've got assays as a quick demo you'll see in a second, and all our strains in here. And another thing you can do is just build it as Excel and get it as Excel. And these are not just like exports, these are also imports. So you can actually do your edits in Excel and upload it, run the validators, check it in the nanobot tool, and kind of go around in those circles. All right, so that was the quick demo, and these were my backup slides in case my demo failed. And then the last bit of my talk, I'm going to show you just what these tools are and how they fit together. So the suite is made from a whole bunch of different small pieces. They're layered. They have very orthogonal design. You can use them individually, or you can use them together, and they're all open source. So COGS is the tool that synchronizes with a Google Sheet, which we saw briefly. And it uses we do a lot of stuff in tables, and we have this like standard message table. So we have this system where we just like output messages from a validator or something as like, here's in the assays table, cell C2, here's an error and whatever. And then our tool COGS will highlight that particular cell and give you a comment on it. So a lot of tools out there get this far and they'll print out error messages. And then the key thing is to close that circle and show people in their spreadsheet where the problem is and ideally how to fix it. Axel does the same kind of thing for Excel. And Valve is our tool for doing that table validation. So we define what the tables are, what the columns are, what the data types should be. And then we can do things like generate those message tables. Sprocket is the table viewer that you just saw, the HTML web app for viewing these things. And so you can see the same kind of stuff that is in the Google Sheet and Excel, but you also get the interactive validation in an HTML form while you're working on these things. And then the tree side of things, a bunch of you know about Robot, I hope. It's a tool that we've developed in the OBO community and for the last 7 years, and we've got about 2,000 commits. It's a real Swiss Army knife of different tools for working with ontologies and graphs from the command line interface. And it moves back and forth between tables and trees because it uses tables for like templates, imports, and reports. But it's a general purpose ontology tool based on the OWL API. But then there are limitations. It's hard to build. It takes like 16 gigabytes of RAM to load the whole NCBI taxonomy into a robot, and we can't afford that all the time. And so my team has built some other tools over the last couple of years that let you work in more lightweight fashions. And so LDTab is for loading OWL and RDF into a SQL database and then querying and editing that stuff in SQL. So any language that can speak SQL, which is any language, can edit your ontology and then write back to OWL and RDF. Wiring lets you build like nice Manchester syntax with links, which I can show you if I have a minute. And very soon we're going to have editing for these things working, which I'm quite excited about. So a web-based platform for editing in Manchester syntax, like you can do in Protégé on your desktop. Gadget is the library that gives you the tree viewers, which we showed. And it can also do fast extracts from large ontologies, like we showed, pulling out a couple of terms from the NCBI taxonomy. And then workflows. So Nanobot is that it brings together the tables and trees. It brings together the validator and the tree viewer that I just showed you, Valve and Sprocket. And it also brings together LDTab and Gadget for the trees. And that's the web interface that I showed you, moving back and forth between tables and trees. And you can just do a bunch of different things with it. So I showed you, well, I didn't quite show you this trick, actually. This is from a demo with Obi, where we browse the tree, and then we click the edit button for a particular term, and then we jump to the robot template for that term, where we can edit that and get more kind of interesting logic. And likewise, we can go from a table like this import table, click on a link, and jump to the ontology definition for that term. And then we can also go to like an upstream ontology, like the cell ontology, find a term that we want, click this to edit the import table, and kind of change how we're going to import it into our ontology. Now, Droid is a web application for branch-based development. The idea is that you log in with GitHub if you have write access, and then you can, you're running branches inside the container. You can do those version control operations. You have curated workflows. But these workflows can be very expensive, running a reasoner or pulling in big ontologies. So we can't just let anybody do that. So we only allow authenticated users to do it, but it's built as a GitHub app. So here's the Droid main page, where it did a bunch of different projects. We pick our project, and then we can go edit a branch, check out a branch. Each one of them runs inside a Docker container. And then I showed you the different things that we can do inside Droid, and check our diffs and make our pull requests. And then this last one in development is Drone. So if Droid is meant for trusted developers, Drone is meant for kind of public contributions. So we don't let people do expensive reasoning operations, but we still give them most of that nanobot web interface. So they should be able to edit tables, and that's lightweight. And then they make a pull request, and then it goes into your GitHub workflow and your continuous integration system. So this is the OntoDev suite of tools. We start with your data. We work with it using a bunch of different open source tools, either together or alone. Put it back into GitHub or GitLab, and then we go through the circle again. And so that's my vision of how we can use tables and trees, branches and workflows to work on ontologies, but also ontology-driven data sets or just kind of big data sets. I want to thank a lot of people. This is my team at Notion, my consulting company. The La Jolla Institute in particular has been very generous when supporting this work over a decade. Other people in the OBO community, technical people. And these are a whole bunch of projects, mostly NIH funded, that have supported this work over the years. So that's my presentation, and thank you very much. I'm happy to answer questions.
Thank you so much. That's an incredible tool that you've been developing. I know I'm personally very excited to use it. We probably have time for one question before switching over. Mm-hmm. Any questions in the audience? If not, I have one for you. I know you mentioned and showed a snapshot of Valve and how there's mm-hmm. some validation rules you've written. I wonder if you could speak quickly on how you decided, at least selected those initial rules, and if you have plans to expand them in the future or what that might look like.
Mm-hmm. It's all supposed to be really customizable. And so the definitions are in tables. And so, yeah, this is kind of the fun thing about it. So your validation rules are in tables next to your data tables. And they don't have to be, but they can be. And so you're editing your rules at the same time you're editing your data. And and then we're trying to build better tools for making that easier. But so this is quite customizable based on, you know, what columns we have and what the foreign key, primary key relations are, and certain tree relationships, which are like hierarchy relationships, which are particularly useful for ontologies. That's the quick answer, but I would be delighted to give you a longer answer anytime. Like, contact me by email or on the OntoDev channel on Slack I just created, or just go to OntoDev and start exploring.